prayer.
Yes.
For me.
Yes, sir.
Amen. It's good. People think enough about you.
Yes.
To remember your name when they go to the Lord.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Amen. I didn't recognize him earlier, but it's good to see my mama and my sister. Family driven up from South Carolina. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. No matter how old I get, I'm still her baby boy. Amen, amen. Glory to God. For those of you that venture to turn with us today, our pericope will be found in the book of 1 Kings, the book of 1 Kings, chapter 19. 1 Kings, chapter 19, starting at verse number 1. Those of you that are able, we ask that you stand just one more time for the reading of God's holy word. First Kings chapter 19, starting at verse 1. And Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, and withal how he had slain all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah, saying, So let the God do to me and more also, if I make not thy life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time. And when he saw that, he arose and went for his life and came to Beersheba, which belongeth to Judah, and left his servant there. But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a juniper tree, and he requested for himself that he might die, and said, It is enough now, O Lord. Take away my life, for I am not better than my fathers. And as he lay and slept under the juniper tree, behold, then an angel touched him and said unto him, Arise and eat. And he looked, and behold, there was a cake, take bacon on the coals, and the cruse of water at his head. And he did eat and drink, and he laid him down again. And the angel of the Lord came again the second time and touched him and said, Arise and eat, because the journey is too great for thee. And he arose and did eat and drink, and went in the strength of that meat 40 days and 40 nights unto Horeb, the mount of God. And he came thither unto the cave and lodged there, and behold, the word of the Lord came to him, and he said unto him, What dost thou hear, Elijah? God's word for God's people. It is blessed, and may that a blessing to us all. Eternal God, our Father, again, Lord, we thank you. Thank you, Father God. We thank you for just allowing us to just be able to come into your presence and call on your holy and your righteous name. We thank you, Father God, for everything that has been said and done here in this service today. We thank you, Father God, for all your precious people that are here under the sound of my voice. And so now we call on you, Spirit of the living God. Fall down fresh and anew on each and every one of us. Anoint us, Father God, from the tops of our head to the tips of our toes, so that we might be more like Jesus. And as always, Father God, your manservant, I pray that you would hide me behind the cross, that only you might be seen. I pray, Lord, that you would speak to my mind and speak through these lips of clay, that I might give your word as you have given it unto me. And then, as always, Father God, I ask for preaching power, the kind of power that makes preaching easy. And Lord, I ask all these things in your Son, Jesus Christ, and our Lord and Savior, his holy and his precious name. And let the church say, Amen. May be seated in the presence of our Lord. For the moment that we have to share today, I want to talk about getting you ready for the journey. Getting you ready
for the journey. As we come now to this last Sunday in this Black History Month, and as we talk about a journey, could not help but think about the journey that our forefathers and our foremothers had to take in order to make it here to America. Can't help but think about the journey that some of our ancestors had to take as they rode that Underground Railroad to freedom. Church, as I think about those things, I can't help but think about the journey that we have taken as a people. Because our journey as a people has taken us from the outhouse to the White House. Taking us from being owned as property to owning property ourselves. That's why when we think about our journey as a people, we got to be able to say, oh, what a journey it has been. You see, because when we flip back through the pages of time, we can see how our people, Black people, African Americans, were treated as property. How we suffered under the hands of Jim Crow, and how we were denied the unalienable rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Although, church, we've had our struggles on this journey, we ought to thank God for our struggles. You see, because it was our struggles that got us to where we are right now.
Amen.
And we ought to thank God for all of our bad days. You see, because it was our bad days that taught us the most in life. You see, because if you know anything about our people, you know that one of the things that we've always done is we've always found a way to turn a mess into a message.
Uh-huh.
But we've always found a way as Black people to turn a little into a lot. Right. You see, because some of you can testify that some of the best food you ever had, it didn't come from no fine restaurant. Some of the best food you ever tasted didn't come out of no recipe book, because it came from mama and grandmama taking some scraps and turning it into a meal. And that's why we ought to thank God for the hard times. Thank God for the bad days, because when we look around and when we think things over, we ought to rejoice that our good days still outweigh our bad days. So we ought not complain. And although we have not realize the dream of Martin Luther King yet, and although we haven't made it to the mountaintop yet, we still can say we sure have come a mighty long way.
Amen.
And I'm here to declare that we never would have made it and never could have made it if we did not have the Lord on our side. I want to let somebody here know that nothing happened to us as a people by accident or coincidence. Everything that happened to us, God had planned it that way. You see, because God, from the beginning of time, he was taking us somewhere, and God was taking us on a journey.
All right.
Every one of us in here are on our own personal and particular journey through this thing called life. You see, but the problem, church, the problem is a lot of us aren't ready for the journey. And the reason that a lot of us are not ready for the journey is a lot of us think that God is taking us on a trip. And if you don't remember anything else that I say in here today, you better remember that a journey is different than a trip. A journey is different than a joyride uptown. A journey is different than a family vacation, because the word journey implies that it's going to be some trouble along the way. And you see, some of us in here can be honest enough to testify that along life journeys, we've seen our share of troubles. And because it didn't matter where we lived, who we were with, what we were doing, or how hard we tried, it seemed like trouble just found our address. Some of us can testify that trouble just had a way of coming and knocking on my door. That's why we have to be honest this morning, church, because all of us have seen our share of trouble. Because the one thing about trouble is it don't care about your age, your color, your money, or your name. Although trouble don't care about your name, there is a name that trouble because the Bible says that the day shall come that at that name, every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess that he is Lord. So as we look at this text today, church, we're not just talking about anybody. This text today, we're talking about the great prophet Elijah. Elijah, this man, church, when you read the book of Kings, he had just came down off of Mount Carmel. He had just defeated the prophets of Baal. He had just spoke and made fire come down from heaven.
All right.
And here he is in our text today, running and hiding as if he did not know who God was or what God could do.
Uh-huh.
How is it, church, that this mighty man of God, this man who was able to speak and make things happen, speak and fire could come down from heaven? How is it that now he's running and he's hiding? You got to ask yourself, what kind of woman was Jezebel? That all she had to do was speak a word and this mighty man of God would run and hide. This mighty man of God, at the word of Jezebel, would go to his God and ask God to take his own life. I don't know what kind of power Jezebel had. I don't really know exactly what kind of woman she was, but here's what I do know. That somewhere between Mount Carmel and getting a word from Jezebel, that Elijah took his eyes off of the Lord. Church, I'm here to tell somebody that anytime you take your eyes off the Lord, that your journey will get tougher and rougher along the way.
Yes, yes.
That's why no matter what happens in life, you know Jesus. Because just like God said to Elijah, this journey is too much for you all by yourself.
Yeah.
You see, because somebody knows that somewhere along life journey, there will be some dark days, there will be some rainy nights, and there will be some storm clouds that gather over your head. You see, but the good news is it doesn't matter what kind of storm it is or how bad the storm gets, because as long as you got Jesus on your side, at any moment Jesus can calm the storms in your life by simply saying, peace, be still. All you got to do is make your way to Jesus. So, church, I just believe that here in the context of these few scriptures, God gives us a few nuggets of the things that God does for all of us to help us get ready for the journey. First thing the text teaches us that God will do is God will provoke a wilderness experience. God will provoke a wilderness experience. You see, because again, most of the time when you talk about Elijah, nobody talks about him running and hiding. When you talk about Elijah, you talk about how he caused the rain to cease for 3.5 years. We like to talk about how he resurrected the widow's son. We like to talk about how he defeated the prophets of Baal and how he called down fire. But again, here in this text, we see Elijah running from this wicked woman named Jezebel. In the midst of his running, Isaiah found himself in the wilderness place, which means that Isaiah found himself all by himself. You see, somebody here knows that if you serve God long enough, that God will provoke a wilderness experience in your life. Because if you serve God long enough, there are times when God has to separate you from your family, your friends, and your finances. You see, because God knows what he has for you is for you. But before God can give it to you, God's got to get you ready for the journey. Sometimes God wants to give you something, but God's saying, not yet. You ain't ready. You can't handle this kind of blessing in your life. God said, I got to get you ready for it, and I got to get it ready for you. Sometimes in order to get you ready for what's ahead of you, God has to separate you from everything and everybody you're used to depending on. And God has to put you in a place where there's nobody else there but you and him. I know that might sound frightening but to some of y'all, but somebody here knows that, listen, that God does some of his best work when he can get you all alone by yourself. Oh, come on, my Bible says that Jacob was all alone when he wrestled with God, and God touched his hip and changed his name to Israel. It said that Moses was all alone when he saw a bush on fire that wasn't being consumed, and God told him, take off your shoes, you're standing on holy ground. Ezekiel was all alone when God took him to a valley filled with dry bones, and God told him, preach to the bones. And in the midst of his preaching, those bones came back together again. And John was all by himself on the island of Patmos when Jesus showed up, and Jesus told him, John, all these things must shortly come to pass. And I don't know about anybody else, church, but I thank God for my wilderness experience. I thank God for my alone time with him, because that's when God does some of his best work on me. That's when God walks with me and talks with me, and that's when God tells me that I'm in his own. And the things we share, oh, why we tell it then. No other, nobody else knows but me and God. The second thing the text says that God will do to get you ready, God will prevent you from quitting.
Just you
live long enough, somebody will tell you in here, if they want to be honest, that something will happen in your life that makes you say, man, I'm through with this. I've had enough of you in this. Yes, I can do bad by myself, but I can also do good by myself. I'm out of here.
That's right.
But you see, the text doesn't explicitly say it. But by the time Elijah got to that juniper tree, Elijah was tired. He was worn out, and he had given up. Because the text said that he called out to God and requested of God that he might die. And he said to God, oh Lord, is it enough? Take away my life.
Uh-huh.
There's a word in there for somebody. You see, because there are times in life when life can and life will get the best of you. If life has never got the best of you, if life has never made you want to quit, want to throw in the towel, then all I can tell you is just keep on living. Life has a way of coming down on you like a ton of bricks. Life has a way of making you feel like you are already gone. Life will do something to you, not just physically, but mentally, that'll make you want to quit. See, because you may never have to sit down under a juniper tree. But let me tell you something about life. Life will have you talking to yourself. Come on, so life will have you crying yourself to sleep at night. And just like it did for Elijah, and just like it did for Jesus, life will have you calling out to God, saying, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?
Yes.
Why is all of this happening to me? Uh-huh. Life will have you asking God, why does bad things keep happening to me? I know bad people out here living good.
Uh-huh.
Ain't got a problem or a care in the world, so tell me, Lord, why is bad things keep happening to me? You see, but the good news in the text, church, there is some good news. The good news is that Elijah was at his lowest point. When Elijah was ready to quit, the text said that's when the angel showed up. God, as I told you a couple weeks ago, God don't show up at the first time in trouble. God don't always show up when the boat starts leaking. No, God wait till the boat been overtaken and is sinking on the peaceful shore. That's when God shows up. Because when God shows up, God wants there to be no doubt about how you made it. God knows if he showed up at the first sign of trouble, you give yourself all of the credit. If God showed up in the middle of your storm, you give somebody else the credit. So God said, I'm going to wait until I get all of the credit for what I've done in your life. Bible says that when Elijah was ready to quit, that the angel showed up and said, arise and eat. And I want to suggest to you, church, that angel just didn't show up under that juniper tree in Beersheba, no, but God sent that angel. Because you do know that we serve an on-time God, which means he may not show up when you want him, but when he shows up, he's always right on time. So all I can tell you is you ought to thank God for not letting you quit. Because I know you thought it was you that kept you going.
All right.
I Because the truth of the matter is, if God had left it up to you, you probably would have quit and walked out and thrown in the towel a long time ago. Somebody can say, but no. God showed up in my situation. God showed up. God gave me the patience to hold on.
Yes.
Just a little while longer. God stepped in and God kept you going when you felt like quitting.
Yes.
And I know some of you think that you call your friends, girl, I thank you for calling me because I was thinking about quitting. Uh-huh. They want your friend.
That's right.
They want that phone call. They want that family member that showed up in the nick of time at the end of your rope. No, that was God stepping in and making a way out of no way. Doing for you what you could not do for yourself. Because God has a way of keeping you going.
Yes, yes.
When you feel like quitting. Lord, there's been some people that be honest enough to say, there's been some mornings you wake up on Sunday morning, you roll over and say, not today. I'm going to catch them next Sunday. God wouldn't let you go back to sleep. He kept nudging you. He kept bothering you. And you finally said to yourself, well, if I can't go to sleep, I might as well go to church. Come on now. We don't wake up every Sunday morning happy and ready to go to church. Some Sunday morning, God got to drag you out of bed and drag you down here.
That's right.
But God said, that's all right, long as I get you here.
Yeah, right.
The next thing that the text shows that God will do for you is God will provide for your needs.
Uh-huh.
You see, because one of the things I love about this text is the angel just didn't show up empty-handed. But the angel, the text says, when he showed up, that he showed up with something to eat and something to drink. You see, because God knew what was ahead of Elijah, and God knew that this journey was too great for him all by himself. You see, but God also knew what he stood in need of, so God kept his promise that he had made to a thousand generations that he would supply his every need. That's why I tell folks, look, I don't need to know what your need is. Because here's what I do know, is that my God shall supply your every need according to his riches in glory. Again, I know that sounds real spiritual, so let me break it down like a fraction for you. Because here's what God's saying. It does not matter how great the need.
That's right.
It does not matter how long you've had the need. Nor does it matter how long the need is. All you got to do is have enough faith to bring it to God. You see, because God has what we like to call a pool of unlimited resources. And when you're a child of God, he tells you to take your bucket of need and dip it in my pool of resources. Again, all you got to do is have enough faith to bring it to God. Good news this morning is that you're a child of God. That bucket of need, you can bring it to him in the morning, in the evening, or late in the midnight hour. And if you know God like I know God, then once you brought it to him once, you can bring it back to him again. And you can keep on bringing it until your cup is running over. God said, my pool of resources will never run out. God said, I can do exceedingly and abundantly with all that you can ask of me. Sometimes you just got to close your eyes and daydream about what the best possible thing you can go to God and ask for. God said, now open your eyes. I can do better than that. I'll supply needs you don't even know you got. But lastly, after God has provoked that wilderness experience, come on, after God has provided for your need, text says that God will prepare the way. God will prepare the way. You see, after Elijah had eaten, he ate so much that he went to sleep. The Bible said the angel had to wake him up and tell him to eat again. Then it said that Elijah arose and went in the strength, not of Elijah. But it went in the strength of the meat he had.
Amen.
You see, God knew that for this journey, if Isaiah, if Elijah didn't have anything, because God knew that this journey was too much for him all by himself. And God knew that he was going to have to travel for 40 days and 40 nights. God told me to tell somebody in here, look, he knows where you have been. And he knows where you are right now. But he also knows the journey that's ahead of you. So you might not know what to do or which way to go, but God does. And if you want at the end of this journey, call life. If you want to end up in the right place, you want to end up where God wants you to be, then let me help somebody. Now might be a good time to connect with heaven's Wi-Fi. Amen. Now might be a good time to download heaven's GPS. You see, because man's GPS is a global positioning system, but heaven's GPS is God's positioning system, which means that God will put you right where God wants you to be, and God will prepare the way before you ever get there. You see, because once you connect with heaven's GPS, not only will God show the way and prepare the way, but there will be times along the way when God has to make a way out of no way, and God has to do for you what you cannot do for yourself. That's why we got to connect with God. So church, as I get ready to take my seat, I want to tell somebody in here that whatever you're going through today, it's no accident. It ain't no coincidence. It's all by God's providence. And it's all God's way of getting you ready for the journey. When this journey is over, when this life comes to an end, when they roll you down that aisle, when the choir begins to sing, and when the preacher begins to preach. Let me tell you something, church. It ain't gonna matter how much money you had in the bank.
That's true.
It ain't gonna matter how many friends you got on Facebook. It ain't gonna matter how many people have connected with you on Snapchat. Come on, somebody. It ain't gonna matter how many degrees you got on the wall. It ain't gonna matter how many letters you got in front of your name or behind your name, because when this life is over, the only thing that's gonna matter is that somewhere along life's journey, you made your way down to Calvary's cross. Because somebody here knows that at the cross is where you will see the light. At the cross is where all your burdens will be rolled away. Because at the cross is where Jesus hung, bled, and died. At the cross is where Jesus went down into a borrowed tomb. And he stayed there Friday and all day Saturday. And then he got up early that Sunday morning. All power in his hands. Everything that God is doing in your life, getting you ready for that journey to the other side.
Yeah.
All of us got to take that journey one day to the other side.
Yeah.
The question that's going to have to be asked is, are you ready? Because when it was time for Paul to take that journey, Paul said to God, he said, Lord, I'm now ready to be offered. The question is not whether Paul was ready, not whether Pastor Singleton was ready. The question is, are you ready? Are you ready for the journey into that far off place?